Beijing Paralympic and Olympic Games are just around the corner, and the excitement is riding high. Andy and I are at a fantastic event called Street Athletics, which aims to get as many young people as possible involved in sport.
On your mark.
But what is it that will make the Beijing Games the greatest sporting spectacle on Earth?
On today's special Blue Peter, we meet some athletes with their hearts set on gold.
I get a crash course in wheelchair rugby.
And Gareth dives in the deep end with diving phenomenon Tom Daly.
One, two, three!
China. More people live here than in any other country in the world, and most speak Mandarin. This year, China is hosting the 29th Olympic and Paralympic Games. This is the Birdnest Stadium, where the opening ceremony will be held on the 8th of the 8th of the 8th. This magnificent stadium will be the athletics venue, holding up to 91,000 spectators. Hockey and tennis venues are situated just a stone's throw away from the Bird's Nest. There's also a brand new velodrome where the cycling will take place. The impressive swimming venue is called the Water Cube. It's made of plastic bubbles that light up at night. It will hold up to 17,000 spectators. China was awarded the Games 7 years ago, and amazingly, the venues at the heart of the Olympics have been built on time and within budget. China's hosting of the Games is controversial. Not everyone likes the way the Chinese government treats some of the people that live there, especially those who live in Tibet. Some people want Tibet to be free from Chinese rule, but China says Tibet has always been part of its territory. Olympic fever is here. For the next 2 weeks, you'll watch world-class athletes competing in the event of their lifetime. But it doesn't just end there. In September, Beijing will also be hosting the Paralympic Games, which will include 20 sports and 472 events.
For every athlete, competing in the Games is all about living the dream. But chasing a gold medal can start off as simply as having a go.
The thing is, you don't have to be fantastic at athletics to get athletes. A t-shirt, a pair of tracky bottoms, and a pair of trainers. Right, I'm off.
I'm joined by Olympic gold medalists Linford Christie and Darren Campbell. You guys have been organising these athletic events, so it's just occurred to me that actually the young hopefuls who sing today, one of them could actually be in the 2012 London Olympics. How cool is that?
It's a possibility. I mean, we've done this because this is how Darren and I started out. You know, we thought we'd bring it to the streets, bring it to the kids, and if one of them make it, then we would have achieved what we wanted to.
Yeah.
Now you got disqualified for zigzagging. You went.
However you choose to get started, all that hard work could eventually pay off with the chance to go for gold.
Lewis Smith and Daniel Keaton have both been selected to represent Great Britain in the men's gymnastics in Beijing this summer. Not bad, are they?
Lewis Smith's strongest event is the pole vault, at which he has been junior European champion twice and Commonwealth Games champion. But the pommel horse isn't the only event required for the men.
Routines are performed on 6 different apparatus. The high bar, the parallel bars, the rings, the pommel horse, the vault,
and the floor. I wanted to know what Lewis's least favourite apparatus was.
I find rings is the hardest piece for me. I struggle with that the most.
Impossible. If you were doing this at the Olympics, how would you get marked?
You can hold the rings like this, which is a perfect cross.
Yeah.
And to make it easier, you shift the rings underneath your wrist, which is a tenth deduction. Then obviously if you're too high, you get deduction. Or if your arms are bent, you get deductions.
Daniel Keating is 18 and the youngest member of the British gymnastics men's team. He's also been cooking up medals, winning silver at the European Championships in 2007 and 2 golds at this year's European Junior Championships.
Let's say you're heading off to a competition, like, how do you get in the zone?
I just kind of run my routine through my head like a couple of times, just make sure I know what I've got to do, keep focused. And I've got to try and get up and do my job.
Is there a bit of a rivalry?
There is, yeah. It's a bit of banter, though. It's good to see each other do well, but it's also good to try and beat each other.
Go
good luck for the Olympics, man. Be rooting for you. Bring a gold medal home, yeah?
Thank you.
Thanks.
Winning a gold medal would be many athletes' dream. Andy caught up with someone who is going after three.
Nathan Stevens will be in the Paralympics this September. He'll be throwing the javelin, the discus, and the shot put. I was keen to learn how to throw the javelin properly, so Nathan took me through it.
Right, the grip is one of the essential parts of the throw. Mm-hmm. So put your index finger around the top of the binding, and then grip with your thumb as well.
Yeah, like
and then
that.
Just wrap your other three fingers around it just for support. You move on to the nice arm position. Just bend your elbow slightly.
Like that.
That's right, so you're gonna use your left arm, you're gonna pull it into your chest, which is called the block,
mm-hmm.
and rotate round. Yeah, but keeping your arm in that position. Turn your hips through.
Like that.
That's it. Instead of stepping into it, you just bounced into it.
And have you always been in a wheelchair, or was it an accident?
No, so I lost my legs when I was 9.
Okay.
Just a train accident. But before that, I was always into my sport, rugby, football. And then after my accident, I didn't know what I was going to do. Didn't want to be one of them, you know, people who didn't want to do anything. I just got back into sports straight away. Just tried to find the one which was best for me, and athletics was the one.
Right, let's give it another one.
Cool.
You've inspired me already with your words of wisdom.
Dropping your elbow in, that's just making a tail. And so when you need to remember to throw through the point.
To get to such a high standard, Nathan works very hard in the gym.
That bit there really feels painful.
He certainly pushed me to the limit.
What's this thing you use?
This is my pole. So I use this to gain momentum when I throw. Basically, when I'm there, it rocks just so I can get a bit more forward momentum.
So what are your hopes for Beijing?
It's going to be a really good experience. I'm really looking forward to it. In world rankings, in my classification, I'm second. I've put the extra training in, get out to Beijing and hopefully bring back gold.
I don't think I'll ever get the javelin, but I'm loving it, though. Great stuff, mate. Good luck.
Thanks a lot.
The Olympics has been around for quite a while. In fact, it all began in ancient Greece nearly 3,000 years ago. Thanks, guys. Back then, there were a lot of wars, but every 4 summers, fighting would be suspended for a month of sporting competition. Greek men would compete against each other in sporting events as a tribute to Zeus, the most powerful Greek god. The events were staged in the wooded valley of Olympia. Running. Throwing. Chariot racing, boxing, and wrestling were all fiercely and sometimes brutally contested.
The ancient games.
The ancient games were banished by the Roman Emperor in the year 393. But they were started up again just over 100 years ago as a way of using sport to encourage peace and friendship. The modern Olympics are now held every 4 years in a different host city around the world. The emblem of the modern Olympics is 5 interlocking coloured rings on a white background, which includes a colour from every flag of every country in the world. The Summer Games aren't just about the Olympics. In 1948, a special sports competition took place in England for injured World War II soldiers. Over the next few years, the event grew and disabled athletes from around the world took part. The Paralympics was born. 20 sports make up the Paralympics today, with thousands of athletes taking part.
Paralympic events are designed to showcase the physical skills of athletes with any kind of disability.
Go for gold, John!
The Blind Five-A-Side GB squad are training hard for this September's Paralympic Games. It will be the first time the UK has entered a team. Dave Clark is one of the squad's top strikers.
Are you looking forward to the Paralympics?
Oh, big time.
Yeah?
It'll be amazing. We're really looking forward to representing the country and getting a medal, frankly.
How does it feel after all that effort when you actually score that goal?
Oh, it's amazing. Amazing, yeah. I have a pretty understated celebration, which is I just walk back to the front row line. Because I can't do a somersault.
Right, Tony.
Pleased to meet you, Andy.
Team coach. Is every player on the field blind then?
Either totally blind or you've got light perception. So you'll see the players, they'll be wearing blindfolds. And in the international games, you also wear patches on their eyes to prevent any use of any sight of goal.
Have you got any tips for me?
The big thing is to listen and trust the coach and the players around you.
Well, I'm going to have a go then, come on.
Excellent. Right.
Jog, steady jog, off we go.
The only way we knew what direction we were going in was to listen to the voices around us.
All right, yeah.
Yes, well done.
Because I can't see. It's like I'm using my ears like a million times more.
Yeah.
And I'm totally using that to figure out where I am.
This type of exercise is watching the players communicate. So they're communicating Ollie's voice, and that's how they actually get their position and orientation.
Yeah, all again. Andy, what you've got to do,
yeah.
You're facing, take your blindfold off a second, you should be facing that way. So concentrate on his voice. So focus
on his voice.
Yeah.
It's really weird because you don't actually know where you are. Okay, talk me through your sport. It's a bit different, obviously, to a normal football.
So what we have inside, about four or five of the panels, is a little envelope with ball bearings inside.
Okay.
And that's what's giving the sound.
All right. So this makes it easy to figure out where the ball is on the field, I'm guessing.
Yeah, that's the only way you're going to
know. Middle left.
The coach taps each goalpost to help the players picture where the centre of the goal is.
Centre.
But this didn't seem to help me much.
And Mozo.
Yep.
It was my turn to see if I could get a proper shot on goal by playing a game with the rest of the team. I wasn't really sure about my chances, to be honest.
My biggest fear in this is actually colliding with someone. So the boys have advised me to keep my hands in front of me. All right, Clarkie. That's it across. And I can't know by where the player is. That ball is just travelling straight across. And that's touched the other player. That's a good pass! And it's great concentration.
Within the blind five-a-side football squad, there is a sighted goalie who can shout out instructions to the players, along with a coach on each third of the pitch.
He struggled a little bit on his orientation.
I felt completely out of my depth.
The board is totally my comfort zone because it's the only way I know where I am.
As a striker, a goal means everything. My one chance at goal. I missed.
All right, be straight, be honest. How do you think of this?
Overall, you know, I think you're really adapted to blind football.
Mate, thanks for the opportunity. I've had a great day. These guys are fantastic.
Check out the progress of these guys in Beijing. I definitely will.
And they got away first time. Christie got a good one. Kaysen going well as well. And it's Christie and Kaysen with Kaysen on the near side. And Christie comes through just outside the world record.
And you still hold the UK record at 9.87 seconds.
I do indeed. And, you know, as much as I enjoyed holding it, I would love, you know, for it to be broken, especially by someone I coach.
We just want to encourage these young people to believe in themselves and don't have any limits.
Well done! Well done! How cool is she?
From one young winner on land to another on water. Meet 25-year-old Bryony Shaw, currently our British windsurfing number one.
It's Bryony's first Olympics this year and she's hotly tipped for gold. And from where I'm standing, she certainly looks like she's been training hard.
Bryony, nice to meet you.
Hi.
You looked amazing out there. You make it look so easy. Where did it all start for you?
Oh, for me, I was age 9 on holiday in France and gave it a go and loved it.
I'm an absolute beginner, so can you teach me everything that I need to know?
Of course. It's a sport for anyone to try, so let's give it a go.
Brilliant.
Bryony has already bagged gold at two international Olympic level events and a silver medal at the RSX European Championships.
Okay, so first of all, hands on, and then climb on with your knees, and then up onto your feet. You feel nice and stable.
Knee. Aha. Feels very wobbly. Very wobbly.
Excellent, Zoe. Well, you've got really good balance. So let's give it a go, up hauling the sail. Okay, now.
you're saying about my balance being good.
I wasn't alone on my first day. It was also Alice's first time at windsurfing.
And what is it about windsurfing that you absolutely love today?
You go quite fast and I do like falling in a lot. It's quite fun.
Do you think it's an easy sport to take up?
After about 30 minutes, it will probably be quite an easy sport to take up. So yeah, you just have to get used to it.
Well, it sounds like you found the perfect new hobby. You love the falling in, you love the speed.
Yeah.
Let's see who can go fastest.
Yeah.
We're doing a spin. Alice and I were supposed to be racing, but it's gone off in the opposite direction. You went out to China last year to do all the preparation work, and you did the race. And you actually came first, you got the gold. So does that put lots of pressure on you to actually get the gold when it comes to the real deal?
It gives me confidence that I've done well in the venue and against the same competitors. So hopefully I'll be able to repeat the same performance.
Well, I'm going to give you this as a bit of a little something to take out to Beijing with you, and hopefully it will bring you some luck.
Your personal Blue Peter badge.
Good luck.
Next up, Team GB's Tom Daly, who we've been following for a while.
Hey, Tom.
Hello.
How do you do something like that? It's just incredible to watch. How often do you have to train to get that good?
We train 6 days a week, and Monday and Friday before school, and Saturday's my day off.
It's not Saturday today, unfortunately. Yeah. What are you going to be training?
Well, I'm going to be doing some springboard.
It's very nice. You're still just dipping your head a little bit on the edge.
Andy is Tom's coach, and he's also one of the Great Britain coaches. Andy, what makes a good diver?
They've got to be very fast, like a sprinter. They've got to have athletic ability and gymnastic ability all wrapped up in one. And then probably most importantly, they've got to be very brave.
How good is he?
I would say he's probably the most talented diver that we've had ever in this country.
Despite only being 12, Tom got special permission to compete in the Youth Olympics in 2007. He won a silver medal in the 3-metre synchro.
How about a jump up 3 metre?
Totally necessary.
Yes, just a jump off the edge. I'm going to have to use the bubble so you don't hurt yourself. Basically, a load of air that comes up and it stops you from slapping your arms or hurting yourself.
Oh,
it's
really?
Like landing in a cushion of air.
Oh, brilliant.
Yeah.
That makes me feel a bit better.
Something that will help you is called a water harness, and it will help you do your somersault.
1, 2, 3, go!
I'm finding this really difficult. And you don't even use this, and you go up 7 metres higher.
Yeah.
I don't really think diving's my sport, you know.
I don't think so either.
1, 2, 3,
go. I'm not sure that was very good. I think I'll leave it to you.
Tom, now 14, went on to win gold at the European Championships this year and is hotly tipped for a medal in Beijing this summer. Good luck, Tom! Now, individual brilliance always shines at the Games, but there are also plenty of events which are all about teamwork.
Wheelchair rugby was added to the Paralympic Games in 2000. The GB team just missed out on a medal in Athens in 2004 by coming fourth. But this year, they are determined to bring home gold. Wheelchair rugby is a very physical sport, combining skills from ice hockey, basketball, handball, with the full-on bravery of rugby. The majority of wheelchair rugby athletes are tetraplegic, people who have suffered spinal cord injury. This means they have some degree of disability affecting their upper and lower limbs. I'm here to meet Josie Pearson, who's the only girl in the squad. I want to find out what it's like being part of all that action.
What
What does it take to be in a team that's good enough to go into the Olympics? What do you have to do?
Oh, you've 110% commitment. You know, it's a full-time job. All of the 12 are full-time athletes, so we'll train at least 5 to 6 days a week, at least twice a day.
Do you ever get any stick off the lads?
Yeah. Well, I give it back.
Andy, you're the captain of the wheelchair rugby squad. Let's say that there's a young boy or girl in a wheelchair that would love to get into the sport. How would they go about doing it?
I would say inquire through the web or get in touch with your local authority sports development officers or go through the BBC online website because there's a disability sports section there and it's very comprehensive.
This is a very tactical game. The chairs are specially designed with a bumper at the front and a guard to protect the wheels.
When you get in the chair, you find yourself really wedged in, but that's the way we are.
Whoa, that is tight.
Let's just go a few pushes forward, just sort of follow me.
Okay.
Follow me.
Hold on, I need to get used to this first, okay.
Let the chair flow when you turn. Someone's
in. I
said
he just did that. The game is four-a-side, played on a basketball court with a volleyball. Players score by carrying the ball across the goal line.
If you see somebody with the ball, go and try and hit them. If you see somebody without the ball, hit them as well. There we go. Yeah, and it goes to Ross. Who's four? Yeah, we've got him surrounded. He's going nowhere.
Where's he going? Is time added onto the game if you, like, get a flat or something?
Every time the whistle goes, the clock stops.
Feeling the burn of this game now.
Hello, Bandy.